Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I'm Reverend Mark Van de Zand. I'm the pastor of First Christian Reformed Church here in Orange City. And I got a phone call on Monday morning asking if I would be willing to officiate at Dorothy's funeral. And I am grateful and gracious that I'm able to do that. Talked to Dennis earlier this week and Jeff as well, and had an opportunity to meet with them. And I'm grateful that I had those opportunities as well, and grateful that God has brought us together for such a time as this. Death is always a challenging thing. There's always many different emotions that come into the heart, into the mind. And in the midst of that, we come before God today to ask for His grace to help us in this time, no matter where we're at, in our feelings, in our emotions, in our thoughts today. So I invite you to join me in a time of prayer today. Let's pray. Loving Father, You are always near to us when we need You the most. In this hour of sorrow, we turn to You in trust and faith, knowing that You love us and are there for us. We thank You for the gift of Dorothy's life that You gave to us for 78 years. Now, as her life is drawn to a close, we ask that You will give Your strength, Your comfort, and Your encouragement to us today. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
During a time of sadness and death and mourning and loss, the best place we can turn to for comfort and for help and grace is God's Word. God's Word really is what gives us that strength and that help in our troubles and our times of loss and sadness. So I want to share a few words from God's Word today that will hopefully help you and strengthen you and comfort you as you go through this loss today. The first one comes from Job 19. Job was a man who dealt with tremendous struggle throughout his life. He lost pretty much his whole life. He lost his family, he lost his children. He had boils all over him, that he took a piece of clay pottery and scratched himself so he was hardly recognizable. And in the midst of all that, he said these words, "I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes. I and not another, how my heart yearns within me." In the midst of that sadness, he knew his Redeemer lived, and that allowed him to be able to go forward in the midst of the struggles in his life. And today, we know that Jesus lives. He came to this world. The season of Advent is a time where we remember Jesus Christ coming to this world as a little baby, and that birth of his life would come to a conclusion in his death, all for us. And Job knew that his Redeemer lived, and I hope and pray that you will as well today. Another scripture passage I want to share to you is Psalm 27. The psalmist writes these words, "The Lord is my light and my salvation, whom shall I fear? The Lord is a stronghold of my life, of whom shall I be afraid? When evil men advance against me to devour my flesh like cancer does, when my enemies and my foes attack me, they will stumble and fall. Though an army besiege me, my heart, it will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then will I be confident. One thing I ask of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple." In John chapter 14, Jesus spoke these words. He said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know the way. So how can we do not know where we are going. So how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." We give thanks to God for his word today. We're also grateful and thankful that we see through this season and through hearing the voice of children that life continues on. And we celebrate that and we are grateful for that. In the midst of death and in the midst of loss, we are grateful that life continues on. The psalmist says, God knows everything about us. He forms us. He creates us. He knows when we sit and when we rise. He perceives our thoughts from afar. He discerns our going out and our lying down. He's familiar with all our ways. Before a word is on our tongue, He knows it completely, O Lord. The Lord created us in his inmost being. He knit us together in our mother's womb. We are fearfully and wonderfully made. Dorothy is fearfully and wonderfully made. Now, God allowed you to have her in your life for so many years, 78 years. Unfortunately, cancer came into her life, took her life. And now the Lord has taken her home, called her home. When I think about that, I'm reminded of these great words in Revelation 21 that remind us of what heaven is really like. It says that I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. Think about those words, that the old order of things will be passed away when Christ comes again. All the tears that we shed today, and in the days that we've had in the past, and in the days to come, all those relationships that maybe were a little bit tattered and torn, one day all those will be perfect because of what Jesus Christ has done. We look forward to that. The song that Dorothy chose for us to listen to reminds us of what that is going to be like, that beautiful day, the song I Can Only Imagine. And Dennis had told me that that was one of the songs that she wanted to have played today, and we're going to listen to that song. The words are sung by Mercy Me.
I'm
Day that will be truly when we get to see Jesus face to face. What a beautiful day and a beautiful image. It's going to be a truly glorious day. A day we get to celebrate. We can hardly even imagine what that's like right now. To have a life filled with no pain, no tears, no sorrow. We have that because someone we love is no longer with us. And so that pain and those sorrows and that tears are there because of that. It means that you love someone. When you cry tears, you shed those tears because you cared about them. You love them deeply, and you hurt for them when they're gone. And so I encourage you, as you shed your tears, to just turn those all over to the Lord and give them all over to God and ask for His grace to help you in those times. And I want to do that with you as a family today. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, in the midst of our sadness, we come before you. In the midst of our sadness, we ask for your grace. In the midst of our sadness, we ask for you to comfort us and help us. And God, we pray this all in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. In mourning the loss of someone that we love, I believe it's always good to remember some things about that loved one. So today, we want to take some time to remember Dorothy and her life. You'll notice some of those words in the obituary that you'll find in your folder that Olman's has. It shares this, that Dorothy was born on September 10, 1942 in Orange City, Iowa. She grew up in Sheldon, where she attended the public school there. As an adult, she made her home in Sheldon and Spencer before moving to Colorado. Later, she returned to Northwest Iowa and settled in Sheldon until April of last year when she moved to Bella Vista, Arkansas with her partner, Dennis. In the early years of her life, Dorothy worked for Dillard's department store selling cosmetics, and I'm sure she bought a few things there as well. She worked also at Village Northwest Unlimited later on in her life. She loved shopping. And she loved decorating and found satisfaction in renovating houses for sale. Dorothy is survived by her partner more than 8 years, Dennis of Bella Vista. Three sons and their wives, David and Mona Brink, Jeffrey and April, or should I say Alice Brink? Lyle and Stacy Brink of Orange City, and a daughter-in-law, Lori Brink of Urbandale. Many grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and sister Trudy Wallstra of Orange City. In addition to all that, we would be remiss to not say and mention the death of her son suddenly 2 years ago, and Stephen passing away unexpectedly 2 years ago. And so she mourned his loss, and that was a hard thing for her and for the family as well. All of that, which you probably are able to read, which I know you're able to read in the obituary, sums up a bit of Dorothy's life. But after talking to Dennis for a while about Dorothy's life, I think it's important to dig a little bit deeper. And as we dig a little deeper, there's an old song that came to my mind as Dennis was talking to me. It's an old song that I think Dorothy probably sang when she was growing up. It's God Moves in a Mysterious Way. The words of this song go like this: God moves in a mysterious way, his wonders to perform. He plants his footsteps in the sea and rides upon the storm. And then this verse: his purposes will ripen fast, unfolding every hour. The bud may have a bitter taste, but sweet will be the flower. As you look at Dorothy's life, you would probably agree that as you look back at her life, there were some things that maybe had a bitter taste to them. Not everything was perfect, not everything was great. And as I think about that, there are three things that I think maybe were bitter tastes at times in Dorothy's life. One was relationally. For from a broken marriage to a death of a spouse to dissonance in the family to relationships that were separated for many years and to the separation of a relationship because of a sudden death of her son. There was bitterness and a bitter taste in those relationships sometimes. Bitter taste in physical challenges. Dorothy last year developed this bone marrow blood cancer, and she lost so much weight as the year progressed. Her abilities decreased, and unfortunately, last week, Saturday, she died at the age of 78, which in today's age is quite young. Also, the bitterness of spiritually, and I think of back to her time as Dennis and I were talking about growing up as a teenager in the church and how there were struggles there because of some things that happened in Dorothy's life and then the church and their responses. So there was some bitterness there as well. Song goes, the blood may have a bitter taste. And so as you look back at her life, you could probably say there was some bitterness to that. But the last part of that verse of that song says, but sweet will be the flower. I think relationally, this sweetness comes after 20 years where her grandchildren were not part of her life. They came back to her life 2 years ago. Through the divorce of her first husband, she was married for 17 years before he died. She had a great relationship with you, Dennis, for the last 8+ years. And through her death, many of her family are here to celebrate her life, which is exactly what Dorothy would desire. So in the midst of the bitterness, there's a sweetness. You guys are together. Here together. There's a sweetness in the physical part of things as well. Dorothy no longer has to deal with cancer. She no longer has to deal with that issue. She no longer has to worry about life and the stresses of life and the physical difficulties and the dimensions that we have in life. She is perfectly healed today. There's a sweetness in that. There's a sweetness also spiritually. Even though Dorothy wasn't an outwardly religious person, from what I've been told, she was a believer. She knew God loved her and cared for her. She knew God was faithful to her. She knew God's constant care over her life. Even though she wasn't outwardly religious, that deep sense in her heart was there. She knew God's faithfulness, which I believe is why she chose for us to listen to this song, Great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness. God, talking about God's faithfulness to us. Even when we turn our backs on him, God never turns his back on us. And so this song, I encourage you just to listen to these words and reflect upon the faithfulness of God and the sweetness that gives to us in this day.
Thank you.
Those words come from the Book of Lamentations. I remember my affliction and my wandering, the bitterness and the gall. I well remember them, and my soul is downcast within me. But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. Great is thy faithfulness. In the midst of the sadness and the bitterness, there is a sweet taste of a flower that ends. And so we're grateful and thankful for that. As we celebrate Dorothy's life today, we're grateful that the bud, even though it had a bitter taste, we know at the end the sweetness of the flower. Will you join me in prayer today? God, we thank you that even though there is bitterness in life, and the bud has a bitter taste at times, we are grateful that you work in such a way that the bitterness can turn to a sweet flower. As we reflect upon the change from bitterness to sweetness today, may you give us strength, comfort, and grace. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you just to pull out your order of service with me, and you'll find in there Psalm 23, a very familiar passage, and if to many of us anyway. I want to just have you read through this and reflect a little bit on those words that you find there of Psalm 23. David, the great king of Israel, wrote these words. He said, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Just want to reflect upon the psalm in three ways today for you as you think about these words, as you reflect upon them, and as you go forward in this day, as you mourn the loss of a dear loved one, and a friend, and mom, and a partner, Dorothy, for so many years of your life. I want you to think about the strength that this psalm gives in the midst of the struggles, the peace this psalm gives in the midst of the pain, and the hope that we find in the midst of the heartache. I want to begin looking at the strength amidst the struggles. The psalmist writes, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want." When we go through struggles in our lives, and we go through many of them, one thing we can be certain about is that the Lord is the one who is always with us. Where others leave us and others go away, there's a constant one to help us in the midst of those struggles. God is there to give us the strength that we need amidst the struggles, the shepherd of our lives, the one that is to lead us and guide us. He's the one that builds us up, holds us up, and carries us through times like this. And I think about that, that God gives us that strength through so many different ways. And I just think about this week for you guys and what you've all gone through and what it means for your life and how God, I believe, has been intimately and intricately there to give you strength. For instance, maybe someone texted you and expressed their sympathy to you or called you, or today you got a hug from someone you haven't had a hug from in a while. Or maybe you experienced a note of encouragement in another way. Or just think of Omens here and the work that they've done to help you process through everything and work through everything and be able to make it through it today. I'm just so grateful for their work in allowing you to be able to have a great service today to mourn and also to celebrate life. That strength amidst the struggles comes from our shepherd, comes from the one who leads us, from the one who guides us. And we can't get that from anyone else. We can't get that from anyone else. God is there to help us. He's there to encourage us. He's there to walk with us. He's there to lift us up. He's there to support us. Sometimes we feel, as the psalmist does in another psalm, like he's a leaning wall, a tottering fence. But in the midst of that, he never falls because God is lifting him up and carrying him. And today, in the midst of our sorrow, in the midst of our struggles, God is here to give you the strength that you need. He says in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5, "Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you." Many of you after today will depart your own ways, some to Arkansas, some to Des Moines, some to Urbandale, some to Orange City. Wherever you go, you're going to go your separate ways, but God is going to be there no matter where you are, to be there as a source of strength for you, to help you, to encourage you. So strength amidst the struggles. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. We also see that there's peace amidst the pain. He says these words, "Even though the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." David, the shepherd, when he's writing this, understands the hard work it is as a shepherd of trying to allow your sheep to be at peace and to find a place for them to rest comfortably. Because sheep, if you don't know anything about sheep, they will not lie down unless they're completely at rest and at peace. And the shepherd is there to give them that rest and that peace. The shepherd is there to protect them. The shepherd is there to guide them. The shepherd is there to direct them. So David says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He's able to give me the rest that I need. I don't have to worry with the shepherd by my side about what's going to happen, because I know I'm at rest and I'm at peace, both now, even when death comes, but also eternally." Jesus said these words, the great shepherd Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." You want peace? You got to know Jesus. Knowing Jesus brings us peace. Without Jesus, there is no peace in our lives. So the Lord is my shepherd. He gives us peace amidst the pain, and in that peaceful situation, he guides me in the paths of righteousness. If we want peace in our lives and in our hearts, we are to be led by the shepherd who leads us in the perfect way, in the righteous way. Many times I believe we don't have peace in our lives because we're walking the path that we want to walk, not the path that God wants us to walk. And honestly, sheep are very stubborn individuals, just like human beings. And maybe just like Dorothy once in a while.
Maybe.
No? Never. Oh, okay. A little stubborn. And sometimes, when we in that stubbornness, we want to go our own way, do our own thing, and walk our own path. But we need the shepherd there to lead us and guide us so that when we go down those paths which are incorrect and stubborn, he's moving us to the green pastures. Not the dry land. He's leading us to the still waters, not the ocean waves. But when we follow the Good Shepherd, we are led to that beautiful place of green grass and peace in our lives. And also, even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we fear no evil because the Lord our Shepherd leads us and guides us. And I think about that in our lives. When we walk through times like this, valley situations which are very tumultuous and difficult and hard, and we shed tears and we get frustrated, we don't know how to respond, when the Lord comes to us, he gives us that peace. He says, "I am with you always. I am there for you. My peace I leave you, do you. My peace I give you. Not as the world gives, So do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. So there's strength amidst the struggles, and there's peace amidst the pain, and there's also hope amidst the heartache. Look at the last little bit of that passage. It says, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Hope. This psalm ends in a place of hope, looking ahead to what's to come, the dwelling place in the house of the Lord forever. Dorothy gets to experience that today. And if we believe the shepherd, Jesus Christ, and give our hearts and our lives to him forever, and we believe that he is my shepherd and your shepherd, you can dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That's the hope we have. That's the hope that we hold on to in the midst of loss. That is where our hope comes in the midst of the darkness of times and the very joyful times. It's all found in following the shepherd. Without that, we won't have hope, and we don't have hope because our future is not secure. But because the Lord is our shepherd, our future is secure forever. And so I pray that the Lord is your shepherd. I pray that the Lord will be the one to shepherd you throughout your life, because when he does, you find strength amidst the struggles, you find peace amidst the pain, and you certainly find hope amidst the heartache. Let's pray together. Almighty God, grant each one here strength, peace, and hope. Grant to Dennis, to David and Mona, to Jeffrey and April, to Lyle and Stacy, to Lori, to the grandchildren and great-grandchildren, to Trudy, and to each one here, the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days to come with courage and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but a thankful remembrance of your great goodness through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And all God's people said, amen. After the parting blessing, Lori will come and she'll lead you in the next section of what to do following the service. We're going to be proceeding to the cemetery and have the committal service there. But I want to give you God's parting blessing as you go. So here are these words. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and all God's people said, amen. Amen.